Okay, so as Jennifer said, I'm Gabriel Martin. I'm Senior Research Associate with the Leangor Center for Construction Engineering and Technology, and also with the Center for Smart Infrastructure and Construction. I'm associated to a project which is about satellite technologies for infrastructure monitoring. This project is funded by the CDBB in collaboration with the Construction Innovation Hub. Today, I'm going to provide an introduction to remote sensing with focus also on satellite technologies for structural health monitoring. And then I'm going to describe the work I have developed so far in this project. So, you know, remote sensing consists on acquiring information about an object without being in contact with it. So typically when we talk about remote sensing, we use satellites, but also it can be done through other aircrafts. For instance, we can use planes for doing so. And in the last year, this has been very popular. Also the use of UAVs and drones and all these new technologies also. But today we're going to focus on satellites. As you know, these satellites are orbiting the Earth. So they usually take advantage of the movement, rotating movement of the air in order to cover very large areas. For instance, in these figures where you can see the Landsat 8 coverage, it has an orbit that goes from the North Pole to the South Pole, and it takes advantage of the rotation movement of the Earth. So after several days, it will cover the whole globe. So with these technologies, we can get periodically images from the surface of the Earth. There are two main, groups of remote sensing technologies. One is optical and the other one is radar. In optical, what we do is we use the light of the sun as a passive source of illumination. So what we measure is the light reflected by the surface of the Earth. And in radar, what we use is an active illumination with an electromagnetic signal that typically is on the microwave range. And they use this microwave range because it can cross the clouds and it can go through the atmosphere very good. So in the radar, we will have images even if it's during the night or if we have cloudy days. In the case of optical images, we have different types of images depending on the spatial and in the spectral resolution. For instance, we have panchromatic images. These images, we only have one band, but they have a very high spatial resolution. These images is kind of grayscale image, but with a very high detail. Then we have multispectral images. In this case, what we measure is several bands at different wavelength channels. These wavelengths typically are selected with some application in mind, because if you want to measure some phenomena, typically there are some specific wavelengths that you want to look at. For instance, if you want to measure something like greenhouse gases or vegetation, if they are going to be measured at different specific wavelengths. So you choose some of them. And on the other hand, we have hyperspectral images, which consist on measure a wide range of wavelengths with many, typically hundreds of narrow spectral bands. So in hyperspectral images, what you have is that for each pixel is kind of, if you have a spectrometer on each pixel, so you get a signature of the spectral signature of the material that you have in that pixel. So this is an example of the bands that are obtained in three multispectral sensors that are the Landsat 7 and 8 that they are operated by the NASA, and also the Sentinel-1, which is operated by the ESA, the European Space Agency. On the x-axis, you can see the wavelength in nanometers, and on the y-axis, you can see the atmospheric transmission percentage, because the atmosphere is not fully transparent and at all the wavelengths. It depends on the wavelengths you, it's more transparent or not. This is what this this background function. For instance, in the 1,400 nanometers, the atmosphere is totally opaque, and also on the 1,900 nanometers. And, you know, these multispectral sensors, they choose some specific bands that we can see in the squares to look at. However, in hyperspectral images, what you do, for instance, the AVIRI sensor, it covers the range from the 400 nanometers to 2,400 nanometers with a 224 spectral bands. So you measure one band every 10 nanometers, so you have a very detailed spectral signature. So you measure everything in hyperspectral. And in hyperspectral images, we can use this very highly detailed spectral information to estimate the materials, even at subpixel level. For instance, using something that technique that we call as unmixing. For instance, if we assume that the spectrum received at this sensor is a linear combination of the spectra of the different materials that are present in one pixel, we can use this model to estimate which are the materials that we have inside the pixel and with which proportions. Of course, this linear behavior is an oversimplification of the reality, but nevertheless, it provides good estimations. So if we represent all the pixels of a hyperspectral image in a data cloud, what we will have is that the spectra of the pure materials will be at the corners of a simplex, and in the faces of that simplex and on inside the points, what we will have are the mixtures of these materials with different proportions. So we can use this technology, for instance, with the resource exploration purposes. This is an example of the cuprite mining district in Nevada. In this image, they have used a mixing technique to estimate different minerals that are present in this area. And also, you can estimate the abundance of each of these minerals for each pixel using this unmixing technique. But it can also be applied to urban areas and to urban scenarios. For instance, this case is an image from the World Trade Center after the terrorist attacks of the 11 September. Here, the use was for detecting the fires after the Twin Towers collapse, but also, you know, this technology can be applied with other purposes. I can imagine that for instance, there are some works that they use these hyperspectral images to study concrete, because, you know, concrete, you have a mixture of several things, and depending on the proportions that you use to do the mix, you have different properties. So you can use these hyperspectral images and a mixing to try to study these properties. So this is everything regarding the optics. Now let's move on into radar technology. The most popular technique for satellite remote sensing with radar is called synthetic aperture radar. It's called this way because if we would like to do radar from the space, the traditional way it's done, we would need very huge antenna on the space, and for obvious reasons we cannot have that. So what in order to being able to do this, what they take advantage of the movement of the satellite along the orbit to kind of, let's say, simulate a bigger antenna. So that's why it's called synthetic aperture radar. And depending on the application and what you do with these images, we have different technologies. One is this interferometric synthetic aperture radar, which we will talk more about this later, but basically it consists on use different images, the face of different SAR images in order to estimate topography and also displacements on the surface of the Earth. Also, we have a polarimetric synthetic aperture radar, which consists on sending signals with different polarization. So the objects will interact with these different polarized signals in different way, and they use this to characterize those objects. And finally, we have TOMUSAR, which similar to InSAR, they use different SAR images taken from different points in order to estimate the 3D properties of these objects. So in SAR, what we have is the satellite emits a pulse. This signal will reach the surface of the Earth, and at some points that we call scatter, it is reflected back to the satellite. So we measure the echo of this signal. With all these points scattered, we can build an image using all these points where the signal is reflected. And because the signal has two properties, one is the amplitude and another one is the phase, what we have is two images. One is the intensity image and the other one is the phase image. So if you see, like, the intensity image is more like a normal image in the sense that we are used to see images. However, if we look at the face, we will not be able to see anything from one image. However, if we compare the face of two different SAR images obtained from two sensors at different and very close position, we will see that these faces are correlated and they produce what we call an interferogram. This interferogram signal comes from different phenomena. We can represent this interferogram as the difference on the face and the interferogram as the sum of different coming from different sources. One is what we call baseline, or here is represented as phi flat, which is this. This is coming because if we measure two different images from different positions, these different positions will see the Earth in a different way, and this creates a difference in the phase due to they are looking at the Earth at different positions. Similarly, we have this phenomena, but due to elevation, if we are looking at the Earth from different position, the elevation is different from these two images. So we have a difference in the phase due to this elevation. We have also a difference if the two images are being obtained in different times and something have moves from the first acquisition to the second acquisition, we will have a change in the phase due to this displacement. And this is what we are more interested in on this in our field. We'll see more about this later. Also, we have a contribution because of the atmosphere. If the atmospheric condition have changed from the first acquisition to the second, the waves will travel at different velocities crossing the atmospheres, and this will create a difference in the phase. And finally, we have other contributions that we summarize on the noise term. This phase is an angle, so it is what we call grab between minus pi and pi. So if we do a cross section of the interferogram, we will see that, for instance, in the left side we have that the phase is increasing, but when it reaches the point of pi, it will suddenly jump to minus pi because it's an angle, so it's circular. And vice versa, if it goes down and it reaches minus pi, you go to pi and so on. So this is what it calls these fancy waves in the interferograms, but we can get rid of this phenomenon by using something that we call unwrapping phase unwrapping. So we will be able to estimate absolute phase from this wrapped phase. So we can, as we saw before, we can estimate displacements between two acquisitions of SAR, two different acquisitions of SAR images using this interferometry. So in satellites, because we are receiving images periodically from the satellite, we can use this interferometry to measure displacements on the surface of the Earth, and we can use this this technology to measure displacements on structures or, for instance, on buildings. What we will do is to we will do is to build a different interferogram, so we will compute the displacements, the relative displacements to each of the interferograms. So at the end, we will have a time series of the displacements of the infrastructures of interest. So we can use these to study the movements of the bridges or of the buildings to monitor these infrastructures. This is another example of the use of this InSAR technology. In this case, it has been used for study the subsidence after some tunneling works in central London. You will see that for these points, there have been some subsidence a long time, so that the buildings are going down with the time. And so if you want to get SAR images to perform analysis, you have different options. There are many satellites, but for instance, the European Space Agency, they have a Sentinel-1 satellite, which provides the images for free, but also you have commercial sensors like TerraSec or Cosmos Climate that they provide much more spatial resolution. So this is the end of the introduction, and I will show you now what I have been working on the project about satellite technologies for infrastructure monitoring. The motivation of this project is that because we are obtaining huge amounts of data from the satellite, we cannot expect to evaluate all this information manually. If we want to do monitor large areas at scale, we need some automatic way to evaluate this information, and in case that we detect that something is performing anomalously, or in case that we detect that there are some risk area due to some ground displacement or something is wrong, we can report to the authorities for them to take a further analysis or to take actions if needed. So the way to do this automatic evaluation is through machine learning technologies. And also over the last year, more specifically, they have been some deep learning technologies that they provide state-of-the-art results in most of the machine learning problems, due to they can model very complex and nonlinear functions, and they can learn very complex and nonlinear features. These deep learning technologies, together with high performance computing, we believe that they will allow us to process automatically this huge amount of data. And with this, we will be able to monitor and evaluate the health of the infrastructure at scale. So in this work, what we are going to do is we're going to evaluate these deep learning technologies, how suitable they are for the processing of this InSAR time series data. So we have chosen a deep learning algorithm. It's called deep temporal clustering. This algorithm is what it does is it is for time series clustering. So we are going to use this time series clustering algorithm to apply to insert time series data. This algorithm, it has it is freely available. It was developed in 2018, and it has two main parts. The first part of the architecture is an autoencoder that learns spatiotemporal features. An autoencoder in deep learning is an architecture which is symmetrical, and in the middle of the architecture, the number of neurons is smaller. So you feed this architecture with the data, with the same data as input and output, and you try to minimize the reconstruction error. So what the autoencoder is going to do is in the middle, because there are lower number of neurons, is going to learn low dimensional representations of the signals of interest. So in the middle is going to learn low dimensional spatiotemporal features. And then there is another part, which is the part in charge of the clustering, which is another layer that is going to perform clustering of these spatiotemporal features in an unsupervised way and no parametrical way. So in order to evaluate this algorithm, we have used both TerraSAR-X data and also Sentinel-1 data. We have use this data over central London in the period from August 2017 to October 2018. We are using a piece of central London in which there is the Battersea Power Station, because we know there have been some works on this area. And because of these works, there have been some displacements in this area that can be seen from the satellite. So these are the velocity maps of the TerraSAR-X and Sentinel-1 images. We have obtained this result using Stamps. Stamps is an open source software that it will do all the multi-temporal interferometry thing. You will provide this software, the SAR images, and this software is in charge of computing all the interferograms, estimating which is the different sources of the signals, like the topography, which is due to the displacements, and so on. So at the end, the output of the software will be the displacements, the time series displacements. That is what we are going to study. And these images represent the point scatters and the velocity, average velocity in millimeters per year. In the two images, we can see that there is a clear some subsidence in this area due to the works on the Battersea Power Station. So we have fit this time series to the deep temporal clustering algorithm. And we have got these two different results. On the left, we have the result for TerraSAR-X. In this case, we set the number of clusters for the clustering equal to 5, but because this algorithm is unsupervised and it is non-parametrical, it automatically decides that there are two classes, in the purple and the yellow, and we can see clearly that it has separated in the purple class those points where we have subsidence, when we have negative displacements, and on the yellow we have those pixels in which we don't have significant displacements. And similarly, on the case of the Sentinel-1 data, we repeat the experiments using the Sentinel-1 data, and again we obtained a very similar result. of course, at a much lower spatial resolution than the TerraSat-X, but we got a very similar result to the TerraSat-X. So we didn't want to stop here, so we did another experiment in which we fit the algorithm directly with the rapid phase data, which is much complicated problem because we fit directly rapid phase data instead of the time series displacement. In this case, we had to set the number of clusters to 2 to make the life easier for the algorithm, because this was much complicated problem. But nevertheless, it provided good results in this case, not as good as in the other case, but I think this opens the door to use these technologies to work directly with the rapid phase. So this is what we have done. We have used deep learning technologies, and we have seen that they can automatically learn to differentiate between points with and without the significant displacement or without significant subsidence. It has been demonstrated that this algorithm can work both with different types of SAR images like Sentinel-1 and TerraSat-X, and they provide similar results. And they can also, of course, with some limitations, but they can also work directly with a rapid phase. In the future, what we would like to do is to validate if this algorithm could be also used to discriminate between different temporal patterns on the displacement, not only to see if there is subsidence or not, but also like discriminate between different temporal patterns. And in order to do that, we want to use this algorithm in a more supervised way, maybe using also measurements from other sensors in the ground as ground truth. I think this would be a good way to make this algorithm learn in a supervised way that improve in this way the results. And also, we want in the future to validate if these deep learning algorithms can be used in at large scale. So this is the end of my presentation, and now I will be pleased to answer all your questions.